It was amazing. It took him 3.5 hours to get down there. I think he spent about 2 hours on the bottom and another 4 hours to get back up. And that's because of this pressure that we mentioned, that you have to really slowly come back up to the surface, because otherwise, well, you would probably die.
The blobfish has been called the world's ugliest animal. It's got a sad, droopy, old man's face, and it looks half melted. But deep underwater, in its natural habitat, it looks much more like a regular fish. That's because the immense water pressure down there keeps it in shape. It's only at the surface, where there's a change in water pressure, that its tissue is damaged, explaining all that ugly. Pressure also explains why we know so little about the deepest, darkest depths of the ocean. In fact, oceans account for more than 99% of the world's habitats by volume, yet we've only explored around 20%. Some people say it's easier for astronauts to explore space than it is for us to reach the ocean floor. So what's going on down there? And what new tech is helping us unlock the secrets of the ocean? We're going to find out today on What in the World from the BBC World Service with me, William Lee Adams. Georgina Rannard is our science and climate correspondent. Georgina, hi.
Hello.
So you spend a lot of time reporting on the ocean. Do you have a favorite fact?
So my favorite fact is actually, it's not about an amazing animal or a strange habitat, but it's that 50% of the oxygen we get on Earth comes from the oceans. And when I first heard that, it did blow my mind. So I thought, okay, so this thing that we're all dependent on, humans, animals, trees, comes from the ocean, which you don't put together water and oxygen necessarily. We can't breathe in the water, right? But it produces the oxygen we need.
So I have a real fear of vast open water, particularly deep water. There's actually a phrase for that, thalassophobia. Are you comfortable in the ocean, in deep bodies?
So I love the water. I want to live by the ocean. I love going swimming. But I think I'm kind of happy at the surface. You know, as long as I've got that connection between the water and the air above, I don't think I could go. You know, we've heard about these people who travel to the very depths, the very bottom of the ocean in submersibles, and I definitely couldn't do that.
So earlier we mentioned how we've only explored around 20% of the ocean. Why so little?
So the oceans are obviously really inhospitable to humans, so it's really difficult for us to go there. It's, you know, one of those ideas is that we've been to the moon. We know much more about the moon than we know about the deepest parts of the oceans. One of the reasons is that pressure. So as you go further and further down into the oceans, all the weight of that water above you is pushing down on you. So that creates this amazing pressure. So at the bottom of the ocean, it's 1,000 times more pressure than at the top. So it's very difficult to cope in that environment. Another problem, or for us anyway, is the lack of light. As you get further down, there's less sunlight. The sun can't penetrate through the water. So it's very dark down there. And also, it can be really cold. So it gets to around 3 or 4 degrees the further down you go. So the oceans are also vast. You know, they're covering 70% of our planet. So, you know, you might get to a point where you've explored really well one column of the ocean, but there's still all this other vast amount of ocean to get to. And it's really expensive, really hard, and humans don't do very well in those depths. Mm.
And the deepest of depths in the ocean, that's in the Mariana Trench. And just so our viewers have a sense of that, you could take Mount Everest, flip it over, stick it in the ocean, and it still wouldn't reach the deepest point of that trench. When was it first explored?
So this is a really sort of famous part of the oceans. It has a lot of folklore around it. People really want to explore more of it. So the deepest part of the Mariana Trench is called Challenger Deep. And that part was first explored in the 1960s. And that was by two men who went down in a US Navy submersible. They were Jacques Picard and Don Walsh. And they managed to get down, but they kicked up so much dust and material as the submersible traveled down. They couldn't really see anything. They didn't get any pictures. And they were only there for about 20 minutes before they had to come back up. James Cameron, famous filmmaker, we know he made Titanic, he went down more recently, and he was able, you know, he's a filmmaker. So he was able to take cameras and took some amazing footage, which is kind of was our first view into this very deep part of the ocean. And then there was another voyage, I think in 2019, and that's when another man went down. It was amazing. It took him 3.5 hours to get down there. I think he spent about 2 hours on the bottom and another 4 hours to get back up. And that's because of this pressure that we mentioned, that you have to really slowly come back up to the surface, because otherwise, well, you would probably die.
The footage that they took, did it look like the rest of the ocean, or were there undiscovered species?
So if you look at the footage, it's kind of, they've essentially gone down into a very deep cavern, and it's covered in strange sediment, these sort of plumes of dust of different colours. They did find and document a lot of new species, sort of countless species that we hadn't heard about before. But a lot of this is also about looking at the habitats, looking at the territory, and trying to understand what type of life form can live there, because scientists are sort of, they're very curious, and it's sort of very uncertain about what type of life could live at such depth without very much light in this kind of inhospitable environment.
You mentioned some of the practicalities there. Pressure, for instance, people have to go down in submarines. How much can you actually explore inside a submarine?
So the technology that we have now to explore the oceans is amazing. It sort of advances every year. I was on a research ship a few months ago in Greece, one of the British research ships. It's not exploring the deep ocean, but it was exploring the sea there. And they are able to send down, they have submarines that they don't have people in them, but they're kind of, they can move through the oceans for months and weeks at a time. They have big robotic, sort of big cubes with arms that they were controlling inside the ship from a control room. And on those submarines or on those robots, there's a whole load of things. There's cameras, so they'll put a light on the submarine or the robot, and they light up the area around them. So the cameras are filming. They film these amazing plumes of gas or dust coming from the seafloor. But also they collect loads of samples. So they have kind of funnels and boxes and robotic arms that can pick up rocks. They can collect gases. They pick up sediment. In the sediment, there'll be different life forms, you know, from the very tiniest bacteria or phytoplankton to fish or examples of coral. So they can, it sounds surprising, but they can really, you know, it's not only cameras, but it's also, they can collect bacterial evidence or gases or chemicals. So there's a whole range of things they're able to sample down there.
I was searching for new discoveries before we met, and I came across this term, dark oxygen. What is that?
So this was a really amazing discovery last year, and it really challenged some of the scientific consensus, which is that you would not be able to have oxygen at the bottom of the ocean because there's no light, and you need to make oxygen, you need photosynthesis, and you need light for that. So everyone always said, no way there's light, there's oxygen down there. And then they found evidence of oxygen, this dark oxygen in these zones where there's no light. So they think that this dark oxygen was made by metallic nodules on the seafloor, and that was splitting hydrogen and oxygen. And it still is a little bit unsettled. Some of the evidence was challenged later, but if it's true, and it does look like it's true, it would create this whole other idea that you have this different form of oxygen on the seafloor, which could be sustaining life down there in a way that scientists didn't think was possible before.
And the ocean, of course, has lots of terrain under the water that we can't see. Have we discovered any new mountains, new trenches?
Yeah, so I think most people, you think about the seafloor, and floor implies flat. You don't always think of it as being this incredibly varied terrain, but it's as varied or even more so than land. So there's huge mountains down there. There's ones that are bigger than Mount Olympus in Greece, for example. There's long mountain ranges. And this, again, they're called seamounts, by the way, sea mountains. But we're always discovering new ones. So it's not like there'll be one main discovery in a year. You know, every few weeks or months, as they're continually mapping the seafloor, there'll be new discoveries of these sort of strange sea mountains. And then in those, they do discover new species and new habitats.
And Georgina, is there a recently discovered animal that you'd cite?
So scientists are always finding new animals in the ocean. Last year, in one study, 800 new species were found. Often, they're not that spectacular. It's a new bacteria or an algae. But they did discover what's called a guitar shark, which, as it sounds, literally looks like a guitar with fins coming off the back, and it's quite flat, with two flat eyes on its back.
And so many of these newly discovered species look quite strange to us. Sometimes they're glowing, they may have odd shapes, they look like aliens. Why are they so strange looking?
So many of them are really weird looking, let's be honest, but it's because they have adapted perfectly to their environment. So there's things, there are transparent fish, there's bright red fish, there's things with bulging eyes. So one of the reasons they're transparent is because obviously they're always trying to, one of your main goals is to escape being eaten by something else. So if you're transparent, that is easier to do. Some of those creatures with the huge eyes, so there's something called an owlfish that has a small body and these huge eyes, and that's because there's not very much light in the deep ocean. So you need bigger eyes to basically capture more light to see around you. Food is scarce, so it's quite a hostile environment. So you're sort of desperate. Fish and other species are desperately looking for more food. So some of them have larger stomachs in order to store food for longer. Some of them have very unusual features to try and capture prey, because again, they can be quite desperate to find food. And then this one is really interesting. Color is really important. So again, you're trying to avoid being eaten by something else. In the deep ocean, the color red is very difficult to see because there's no light or very little light. So lots of species are dark red because then they can't be seen by their predators. So to their predator, they look invisible, or like they're not there at all.
Some people might say, all right, this sounds cute. What's the point? Why do we need to be down there?
Increasingly, scientists want to understand it because of the role it plays in creating our habitat. You know, it creates 50% of the world's oxygen, but also its role in climate change. So the oceans have absorbed 90% of the heat, the excess heat that we've created on Earth by burning fossil fuels. But as climate change increases and the oceans become more fragile, that balance is shifting. So scientists want to understand what exactly is happening there. So there's something called the biological carbon cycle, or the biochemical carbon cycle, and that's when small, tiny creatures in the oceans are absorbing carbon and taking it down to the deep ocean. And that is part of this huge carbon cycle that is protecting the planet. But it's really poorly understood. So that's one very important reason for scientists to understand how exactly that works and what does that do in terms of protecting us, humans and other species from climate change. But another reason is that there's lots of natural resources and potentially very valuable minerals in the oceans. And you may have heard of deep sea mining, which is quite a controversial area. As technology advances and as we need more renewable technology or different types of minerals to support our phones and our computers, there's greater demand for these minerals. And one of those places where they exist is in the deep ocean. But there are big questions about should we as humans be going down there and mining these minerals, and what damage that could that create?
Georgina, thanks so much for explaining that.
Thank you, William.
Thanks for watching another episode of What in the World from the BBC World Service. Do scribble your comments down below. And if you enjoyed, why not join the more than 1.4 million people who already subscribe to the BBC World Service YouTube channel? I'm William Lee Adams, and we'll see you again soon.
Bye.